Okay, fixtures and factories. So one of the things that I sort of pointed forward to in the last example was these mock objects are pretty stupid. You can sort of make them obey specific behaviors so that they can do just enough to get you through some test that you have to do. But at some point, you end up figuring out that you might need a real object. So what would be an example of that happening? So here's an example, right? Suppose we were trying to test a new method in our movie class called Name with Rating. And the idea is that all it does is it takes the name of the movie, it puts the title together with the rating, and you just get a string with both. Pretty trivial, but for the purposes of example, well, one way to do this, if you're just sort of not thinking ahead too far, is, okay, no problem, I will make a mock object for as a stand-in for the movie. But wait a minute, the name with rating method is going to have to get at the movie's title, so I better stub that and return something like a title, and oh, it's also going to have to get at the rating, so I should stub that. And by the time you get to this line, you're like, wait a minute, this thing has to kind of do everything a real movie would do, so wouldn't it be better to just use a real movie in this test? And indeed it would. So the question is, where are you going to get a real movie to use in a test? And there's sort of two major categories of ways you could do this. One of them is you could create a fixture, which it's a term that comes from the mechanical engineering manufacturing community. A fixture is a piece of equipment where you put the object that you're testing to hold it still in some known position. And in software testing, a fixture is one or more data items that are sort of preloaded at the beginning of time with respect to your test cases. So they're sort of always there. It's like starting with the database having a known state with some objects already in it. Or you could use a factory, which is, if you come from the Java world, it is similar to the concept of a factory in Java. It basically means I'll just create the specific objects I need on a test-by-test basis. They're going to be real objects, but I'm not going to sort of pre-populate the database. I'll just create the ones I need and destroy them when those tests are done. So let's take a look at each one of these. So starting with fixtures, conveniently, Rails will arrange to completely wipe out and reload the entire test database before each spec is run. Now, technically, if you're familiar with databases, it doesn't really wipe the whole database. What happens is it runs every spec inside a transaction, and then it rolls it back. If you're unfamiliar with databases, don't worry about that. The way to think of it is your test database starts out clean at the beginning of every single spec, and if you have some fixtures, those fixtures are loaded in before every spec is run. So the way that you would do this is if I had some movies that I wanted to put into my database, I would create a YAML file, which you've seen examples of already, showing some movie information, and at the top of my test file, right inside my describe, I would add fixtures colon movies, and bingo, anytime I run any spec, all of the movies in my YML file will be preloaded into the database, and my test can assume that they're there. Seems pretty good. But one of the problems is that this kind of breaks the independence of your test, or it has the possibility to break the independence of your tests. There we go. Sorry, I'm having PowerPoint issues today. The reasons to use is if you have some static data, for example, your app has some configuration info that never changes, but without that information in the database, your app won't run. Stupid things like, you know, the time zone that it's in or something like that. It's reasonable to use fixtures for that because in some sense, every test has the same type of dependence on that information, which is the app won't even run, right? You can think, well, if I have all of my movies in one place that I'm using in my tests, I just have to edit that one file. Those are good reasons to think about using them, but the main reason not to use them is that it introduces a dependency on fixture data. So all of a sudden, if you've got some tests that, for example, count the number of movies in the database before and after some operation, if you now add a new fixture for the purposes of some other test to use, the first test might just break. Even though you haven't changed any code and you didn't introduce any bugs, you've introduced a dependency between a global set of data and a variety of tests, not all of which depend on all the data. So that's not necessarily good. So the alternative is a factory, which is the more popular way to do this. And the idea is that you can set up these little helper methods that quickly create real objects, but you kind of have a set of default attributes. So you could just say, look, give me a movie. I don't really care what the title is or what the rating is, just so long as it's a valid movie object and has sensible values of those attributes. And the idea is that this is so easy to do that each test just creates the ones it needs, and then they get destroyed when the test is over. So one example, a pretty popular gem is called Factory Girl. This one is installed with the bookware, and I would recommend if you're going to use factories, this is a pretty good way to do it. Here's an example of what it's like to do. you set up a factory subdirectory where you create a file for each type of object that you might want to create instances of in your tests, and you tell Factory Girl, when I need a new movie, by default, just create a movie with a fake title and a rating and that was released 10 years ago. And when I want to actually create one of these in my specs, I say, Factory Girl, build me a movie. And by the way, for this one, I actually want to control what the title is, so I'll override the title. But if I had left that out, I would just get back a perfectly valid movie with a title and rating I don't care about. But critically, it has all the behaviors of a movie object, right? So I can actually pass that around and use it anywhere that I would use a real movie object, and everything should just work. So this is kind of the Factory Girl approach to doing it. And by the way, if you don't want to use a separate gem like Factory Girl, there's a directory called support where you could write your own helper methods that create custom versions of objects. But I did this once, and what I found is I should have just used Factory Girl. Okay, so what's good about this? Well, the good thing is your tests are independent, right? The objects are created and used only by the specific tests that need them, so they don't affect other tests that don't care about those objects. One possible reason not to use it is that complex relationships might be hard to set up. So very shortly, we're going to start talking about associations between entities. Like, there's going to be movies, moviegoers, and reviews, and movies have a lot of reviews associated with them. And you might find that, oh gosh, when I need to create a test to find out whether a movie has a certain review. That means I got to have a factory for the movies, I got to have a factory for the reviews, I got to link those two things together. But of course, when you find yourself thinking down that path, as we'll soon see, what it really means is there's something about your code that doesn't allow them to be decoupled. If it's really true that you've got two objects that are so tightly related that you can never use the one without setting up the other, that's a signal that you need to provide some abstraction so that you can actually manipulate them separately, and that would improve testability. And as an example of what can go wrong with this, this is called a mock train wreck. That's a real term. And here's a hypothetical scenario. Let's say that I have a test, and what I'm testing is, can I search for a movie by its director or by the awards that movie received? I have an award model and a director model, so I'll create a mock of the award model of a certain type of award. I'll create a mock of a director model with one of the 20th century's most brilliant directors. And now I can create a movie model that has a certain type of award and a certain type of director. Yuck, right? Now in my test, I'm saying the movie.award.type and movie.director.name.breakitintowords.double-backpedal. No, right? This is telling you that your code is not factored well enough to allow awards, movies, and directors to really be managed separately. Right? This is a mock train wreck. You have to set up all of this state so that you can do this. What that means is if the director really matters on its own, or if the award type of the movie matters on its own, the movie class should give you a way to get those things without having to know the internals of the other object that it depends on. And when we talk about design patterns a little bit later on in the course, we'll see that this is an example of breaking an anti-pattern, right? This is an anti-pattern called inappropriate intimacy, right? Not only do you know your friends, you know a little too much about your friends' friends.